I don't really know that much about Skaka, but from the other day, I learned that he doesn't like roping or people who rope against him. I think I will rope him.
I definitely know of him. He's always been a big fan of Shaman, and he actually brought it here as well, so it's pretty cool. Unfortunately, now I have to play against him, so maybe I'll knock him out, but we'll see.
I think Osaka definitely underestimates APEC. Even though we are less known, we all practice really hard, just like they do.
He's actually one of the most like technical players. He really like takes his time on every turn, and so you can tell that he's a really good player when you see him play.
Osaka is a really good player, and so am I.
I'd say that he brought some pretty straightforward decks.
I have one message for my opponent. The elements will destroy you.
Osaka versus Penping Ho!
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to Hearthstone World Championship. The players are almost ready. They are taking their positions. I'm your host, Nims, and I'm here with Robert and Amaz. We're going to bring you this amazing game.
Yeah, really really interesting series coming up here. We have two players who are kind of pride themselves on different styles of winning. Penping Ho obviously really values playing Shaman. He likes innovating. That's kind of his thing, whereas obviously Osaka comes from a pedigree of being one of those really high-skilled technical players. So two different very different styles. I want to see how it turns out.
Absolutely.
And at the end, both the players are really, really skilled. I mean, I can't say that one person's technical level is greater than the others. They're both really, really good. And it really comes down to the deck list that they're bringing. We see that Osaka is kind of bringing a lineup similar to Tice, where he's bringing Patron Warrior and Freeze Mage as well.
Yeah.
And we're going to see if he can follow in Tice's footsteps to the semifinals.
On the other hand, there is the Shaman from Penping Ho. But the big question, I think, is what does their Hearthstone say? And what do they say through the gameplay? Because Penping Ho is from Type 1, and he wants to prove himself to his countrymen through the game itself. I think they don't respect him that much. So, you know, through the gameplay and through qualifying here and winning the World Championship, he wants to say to reach their hearts with the game itself.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, he wasn't born in Taiwan, he was born in the States. And, you know, sometimes, since you're not a true Taiwanese, you know, you might get some people feeling otherwise. But he's here to play the game, he's here to prove himself that, you know, he belongs in the top Hearthstone players in the world. And, you know, he's brought Shaman, he's really confident with it, and he plays a lot of Shaman, so we're gonna see some very crazy combos, hopefully.
Absolutely. Robert, what does Osaka's Hearthstone say?
I think, like I said, he comes from a group of players that all practice and scrimmage together a lot, and their big thing is just not misplaying, right? They go in there, they bring decks that they found to be extremely powerful, and the goal is to just not, you know, be affected by nerves, not be affected by other considerations, and just really have strong play throughout the series.
All right, makes a lot of sense. All right, guys, game one is ready. Osaka versus Penping Ho, Warrior versus Druid. Let's look at the hands.
Yeah, Penping Ho's hand is looking pretty good. He has the Innervate and the Wildgrowth. Usually, Ancient of Lore is pretty good against, you know, games that go pretty long. So, you know, if Penping Ho feels like that the Patron Warrior is not going to establish a lot of creatures at turn 5, then he can keep that for, you know, card draw. But he's going to look for some early plays.
Right, so ever since, obviously, Warsong Commander was changed, Grim Patron's identity as a deck has changed with it. I've talked to a lot of players who are still playing it competitively, and they say that this is actually one of the best matchups. Mid-range Druids specifically, they feel they have a great leg up against it, that they can basically outscale the Druid in terms of burst damage, combo notwithstanding. So Osaka has to feel pretty confident about this matchup. And for Penping Ho, as you guys pointed out, incredible opening hand. Just he's going to accelerate to, you know, really high mana totals quickly. He's going to be able to play a lot of what comes off the top of his deck very, very shortly. So very good opening hands for both players, I feel like.
Yeah, absolutely. It feels like Osaka is ending in a good matchup, especially after the recent additions of the bigger cards, like Sludge Belt. Is he running Sludge Belchers as well?
Well, here we see actually he has had Lothar in his hand, and it's going to be, you know, a very formidable minion. 5/5 is exactly what you want against a Druid, because Swipe doesn't clear it, Wrath Hero Power doesn't clear it. It's going to do something.
I think Sludge Belcher's inclusion is kind of a more recent thing. And when these players submitted these deck lists, this was back in the time where I think the main difference is you were seeing Shredders, Lotheb, and Dr. Boom.
And Grommash.
Yeah, Grommash is thrown in there as well as the finisher. And it's a very powerful deck in its own right. The biggest difference, aside from, you know, obviously just crazy damage all in one turn, is you have to really make careful decision making as far as how greedy you're willing to be. Because the core theme of the deck is still drawing a bunch of cards, having that card advantage, and leveraging it to win the game.
Yeah, it's a pretty interesting deck, but on the other hand, Druid can stop it. As you mentioned, Robert is a really good start with the ramp, and originally, how Druid was stopping Patron was just with the minions. Just drop as many minions as possible in the beginning of the game so that Patron can't go with the Patron Whirlwind effect to get a couple of dudes on the board. Just counter that with your own minions.
Right, and Proskaka now, he got that Death Spite in the opening hand, which every single mulligan guide I've read now for this deck just basically says you hard mulligan for weapons. That's all you look for, because the Death Spite, the Fiery War Axes allow you to 2-for-1. You can leverage your health total as a resource, get rid of other minions off the board, and Oskaka's obviously got two weapons in hand, so he's in a pretty good spot, although he was not able to deal with Darnassus Aspirant, and Darnassus Aspirant staying on the board could prove problematic.
Yeah, but Pimpinho unfortunately can't really use that mana crystal that's provided by Darnassus Aspirant right now, so he's just going to continue wrapping up and hope for some bigger minions that perhaps will come later down the line. But yeah, speaking about the Deathbite, I mean, what else do you want to do as a warrior in turn 4, right? You just want to play the Deathbite, such a strong card. So we can also see that that's why that's the only 4-drop in the deck usually.
Aside from Shredder.
Right, exactly.
Shredder is a little bit more of a proactive play, but the Death Spite just has so much immediate effect on the board.
So at the moment, Oskaka has the Death Spite, as you guys mentioned. He has Patron as well. He's looking for an Inner Rage on or a Whirlwind. He has the coin as well, so on 5. If he develops the Death Spite on 4, he will be able to follow up with Patron into coin Whirlwind on maybe Inner Rage. His plan is to have those Patrons as soon as possible on the board and clear the board as he goes.
Exactly. Very difficult for a Druid to deal with such a big Patron board, right? Swipe deals one damage to a Patron that's perhaps not at one health, and it's just going to cause more problems. So that's exactly the game plan.
You know, for Pimpinho, he's in the position where, obviously when you're the Druid, you want your Innervates, you want your Wild Growths, you want your Darnassus Aspirants because you want to ramp up, but there's a point where you maybe have too much ramp. You're not drawing into enough threats, and Druid kind of, I still think, has to be the aggressor in this matchup.
Yeah.
Because over time, the Patron will use stuff like weapons, those mid-range drops, and then obviously, as you pointed out, Grommash to seal the game. Very advantageous for Pimpinho that he got that Ancient of Lore.
That's
he can
so
innervate
huge.
Straight into it. He puts a 5-5 on the board, going to draw cards, obviously, since he can't heal himself. So this was a great draw for Pimpinho, and I think this was kind of that last turn where he was either going to get the threat or fall way too far behind.
Right. Yeah, this was the exact moment when he needed it, because he is, as you mentioned, the beatdown. He needs to be aggressive. Not only Grommash is the good finisher for the Patron deck, the fact that you have Battle Rage, is he running Battle Rage, this version? That might be the version with the Battle Rage, so really similar, where you have all the draw. So if you, Druid goes card by card with the Patron will outvalue Druid in the end.
Yeah, Patron still requires the Battle Rage to cycle a lot of cards. Obviously, you can get some off Acolyte of Pain, Slam, but Battle Rage is where you're going to have those turns where you can potentially, after making Patrons, draw upwards of 4 or 5 cards.
I really like the fact that even though Warzone Commander got changed, we still see Patron as a valid deck, and it got a bit better, I think.
Yeah, it got a little bit more strategic. Since your Patrons do not necessarily have charge right now, you do need to set up for the next turn and, you know, kind of predict what your opponent's going to do in response to it.
All right, so for Pimpinho, it seems like Azure Drake might be the play to draw the card, but on the other hand, there is the Death Spite that's going to deal with it easily. Is there anything else you guys would see as a good play here?
Well, he does have 2 Big Game Hunters. He could just throw down one of those for fodder against the Death Spite, because one of the valuable key things about Azure Drake is that it does give the spell power bonus to swipe, and it could clear a lot of Patrons. Especially if it's only on a board of 4 Patrons, right? One's 3 health, one's 2 health, and the other's at 1 health. That's like the perfect way to deal with that.
On the other hand, you have to expect Dr. Boom and Grommash from this deck as well. So both Beacon Hunters will provide a huge tempo swing if they reach their target.
I actually really like the idea of seeing a Big Game Hunter come out on the last turn, because you kind of put him in a position where, you know, he either has to waste a second weapon charge or find an Inner Rage, something. He's going to have to use another resource that he doesn't want to use. Obviously, we see Pimpinho chooses to go for the Drake. That's completely fine. You put it down. That's 4 damage that if Oskaka chooses to swing into it, he's going to have to take. You get a card off of it, and you just kind of wait for that weapon to go away, and then you can start playing down stuff like, Druid of the Claw.
Yeah, I like Azure Drake in a way that it actually forces the attack. Like, you can't leave Azure Drake on board. You have to do something with it.
Yep. That's true.
And maybe that's not the turn that Pimpinho wants to go with the Patrons. And looking at his hand, it is not the turn. Just getting 2 Patrons will be easy to clear. He's actually going for the Patron here.
Right. I mean, you might as well, right? You have a coin Dr. Broom, which is a very solid turn 6 play. So you might as well create a little bit of disruption for your opponent's plans.
That's really brave. This means that he is not afraid of Keeper of the Grove and Wrath, maybe. Is there a good way to clear those Patrons?
That's something else to consider, is Pimpinho's on 7 mana this turn. with nothing else on the board, clearing the patrons, it required him to have very specific answers. It basically kind of has to be something like Wrath Swipe to get those off the board cleanly.
Savage Roar and Swipe as well.
Right, sure. So there, but it required very specific answers, and since he had nothing on the board, Druid actually, once you get past the mana acceleration, is a pretty honest deck. It does a lot of trades, it has some direct damage, but other than that, it doesn't have like any super fancy Blade Flurry combos or anything like that, so I do like that play from Moskaka. I think it's completely fine, and we see here Pimping Ho doesn't necessarily have a super intuitive way to deal with this.
Yeah, the thing is, like, he can use Savage Run and Swipe, but on the other hand, he's seen Moskaka not using any Whirlwind effects.
Right.
So he might feel like, hey, maybe he doesn't have that Inner Rage. He doesn't have Inner Rage. He doesn't have the Whirlwind as well. So those patrons are gonna stay as long as I'm not gonna play something big. So, and he goes for Druid of the Claw exactly because of that.
It's so risky. It's such a risky line of play, though.
Right.
One where he could very, very easily get punished by Moskaka if Moskaka has those mechanics in his hand. All right, let's see what he gets here.
It might be a bit greedy, but it's something that may pay off, and he's also expecting Dr. Boom. There is the coin,
right.
So he knows that if Dr. Boom comes down, this patron is just going to die to the cat, and he has the Biggin Hunter ready.
Yeah, right. So because you can coin out Dr. Boom, then it's totally reasonable. The patron thing didn't necessarily pan out, but it didn't hurt you much either. You obviously got the one free patron off of the original patron, so the idea that the Druid of the Claw trades into one, it actually comes out fairly evenly.
Yeah, it's actually pretty cool that patron warriors are starting to, you know, turn to other win conditions now that the Warsong Commander is not available. You have Dr. Boom, you have Grommash, so it's definitely more board-centric and very interactive, you know.
Yeah, that's a lot more interaction going on there, so... So speaking of interaction, that cat's about to get interacted off the board.
Yeah, executed fully. Moskaka recognizes that Biggin Hunter is a possibility. That's why he goes for Lothab and Patron, trying to protect his Patron here. Also, you know, there is a lot of all the cards we mentioned, being the cards to counter Patron, were spells.
That's obviously, you know, 2 damage or 2 health Patron, easily removed by Keeper of the Grove, so... Pimping Ho just goes ahead, gets it away. He doesn't have to deal with it anymore. Doesn't have to worry about Whirlwind, Inner Rage, those kind of things coming out. And he really had limited options anyway as far as what he could do because of the Lothab effect.
Yeah. So. I love this Biggin Hunter play. It basically says that, Moskaka, you have to clear both my minions to ensure that you do not get killed by combo, which he already has in his hand. So Moskaka just can't play develop Dr. Boom, for example, and you know, stay alive.
Yeah.
It's not possible.
And Pimpico does have the combo, he does have double swipe as well, so he is in a great position to rush Moskaka. Moskaka doesn't have the way to... Well, he can clear, but it's not really winning play. He is behind, he is trying to stabilize.
Right, and this is the point as the Druid player where, as Amaz points out, you can just keep putting out minions as you get them, and the onus is on the other player to clear them every single time, or else you're just going to kill them. And interesting point, compared to your older patron list prior to the Warsong Commander nerf, you don't see Shield Block anymore. And Shield Block was really good for dealing with Druids because it gives you that 5 armor immediately. It helps you cycle to other cards, but since that's been cut from the list, that's it's just actually more HP that, you know, the warrior doesn't have access to.
Absolutely.
And Moskaka realizes, you know, the danger of just losing the game right now. Gonna spend the coin for the hero power for two extra health, and it's gonna save him here.
If he would not do that play, he was dead.
Yeah,
that was 20 points of damage incoming.
I mean, obviously, the main win condition is not being dead.
Yeah, right,
really,
right.
Moskaka electing to not die is gonna help him in
well,
the future.
The main win condition is killing your opponent, but then, you know, you also have a second condition that you can't die first.
Well, it's you can't do that if you're dead.
Exactly.
So you gotta stay alive first, so then you can kill your opponent.
Right.
And that makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
And Moskaka, I think, also realizes the Pimping Ho playing the Big Game Hunter means that his hand is, like, you know, perhaps not the best, so the combo has a more bigger possibility of being in.
The big question is, what do you do now as Pimping Ho? You can combo, but I think Armor Smith is something you absolutely need to kill. On the other hand, you have the swipe as well. Does double swipe make any sense?
Yeah, you kind of do have to clear the Armor Smith. It does represent, you know, a lot of health, especially with all the Whirlwind effects. So we'll see how he chooses to deal with this.
It looks like he might just actually ignore the Armor Smith for now.
Wow.
The left is off the board. Tier power here, I think.
Okay.
Yeah. Well,
with this, it seems like Moskaka will be at 16 health, and then there is 14 damage from the combo, 4 from the Biggin Hunter. So Pimping Ho is setting a trap. If Moskaka kills Biggin Hunter with the weapon and just armors up, combo will be enough to finish the game.
All right. Luckily for Moskaka, he got a Drake Corsair. A 1-mana 3/3 taunt is pretty good, and he can even play that with Dr. Broom if he chooses to go a little bit more risky.
Well, after seeing double Big Game Hunter, yeah, you could probably play it safely.
I mean, you do need to develop minions on the board to win the game, but really depends on what line he chooses. He could just, you know, in a sense, fatigue the Druid out of his cards so that he just wins minions regardless in the end, or he can just choose to take a stand here and develop the 7-7 and 2 Boom Bots.
Right, so for Pimping Ho, the name of the game just continues to be try to get your opponent to a point where they can no longer deal with minions or you have enough guaranteed damage. And the Armorsmith without a bunch of minions on the board isn't actually representing too much health per turn right now, because obviously Armorsmith, the effect only benefits when you have minions, so. Yep. Sets up a wall there, and yeah, he's going to play that Dr. Boom because at some point he has to try to win this.
Yeah, absolutely. And with this, he also knows he's not dead to combo.
Now, that's the problem with leaving up an Armorsmith. Effectively, all your minions gain death rattle, gain and armor, right? So right now, Pimping Ho's swipe is not looking too good. You might have to find something a little bit more creative.
The big question is, does he have a choice to do anything else?
I love watching Osaka play this deck because there are so many decisions involved in playing this deck correctly these days, and Osaka's such a good decision maker. He kind of, again, going back to coining out the hero power to survive, plays down the Dread Corsair, plays down a bunch of minions around it to where, again, the Armorsmith can really profit from that, get him a bunch of HP, and Pimping Ho's sitting there with a lot of damage in hand, but there's no real way to just immediately do anything. He has to get through that Dread Corsair, and then he probably has to kill the Armorsmith, and yeah, I guess in this situation, Pimping Ho might actually come into a little bit of trouble because he did not choose to clear the Armorsmith the turn before.
Skaka is so patient. Oh wow, Pimping Ho is going for double swipe on Dr. Boom, I believe. That's a lot of armor.
That's right, the Armorsmith is effectively getting 8 procs and still stays alive.
So Pimping Ho goes for the play to clear the board and give himself more time. He is the beatdown when he realizes that at this point, just needs to clear the way for his minions. And if he has a big Druid of the Claw next turn, maybe that'll be enough to stop Osaka.
Yeah, so we see the Frothing come off the top for Osaka, and Frothing Berserker extremely powerful still in its own right, but it's kind of one of those things where in this situation, it doesn't go fast anymore. So it's going to have to wait a turn before it does something. And, you know, we see that Pimping Ho, while he may not necessarily want to do it, does have tools to deal with something like a Frothing Berserker.
Yeah, this means that Osaka is going to just develop the board, play a couple of minions, have more of them. Acolyte of Pain can draw him cards, interact with Grim Patron. And, you know, it's some damage as well. Even though those minions are small, they are dealing damage. And if he picks up a Whirlwind, this will empower the Frothing Berserker here.
Yeah.
Yeah, even small creatures like the Acolyte, which is just a 1-3, is very annoying for a Druid to clear with because, you know, usually they do a lot of damage to one creature and try and kill it that way, but we can see that Force of Nature, Savage Roar is so inefficient in dealing with these, you know, small creatures.
Yeah, Whirlwind would be the dream draw for Osaka with the two Acolytes down, the Frothing Berserker, draw a bunch of cards, activate your Berserker to get really big. I think this is a totally, totally reasonable play. You just have to get that Berserker off the board. But, you know, Pimping Ho as the Druid player is now playing from behind. He's just answering threats, which is not where he wants to be against the Patron Warrior.
Yeah, and Osaka actually has more cards in his hands than appears because he does have those Acolytes. And in a rage, he can even draw more cards.
Or you could play Grim Patron.
Yeah, Inner Rage Patron seems really strong.
Yeah.
Especially because Druid is running out of cards. So you might put Pimping Ho in a position where he needs to use the combo to clear the patrons. Yep. So right now, the game plan is changing for Pimping Ho because, as you mentioned, Robert, he's playing from behind. So now, instead of just trying to rush Warrior, he'll try to eliminate all the threats that Warrior has in their deck.
Right. And we see he is going with, as Amaz said, that Inner Rage on the Acolyte, which is totally reasonable. He's going to draw some cards. Ends up getting 2 cards off that Acolyte. It was second Inner Rage. Now, I would be curious if he chooses to use that second Inner Rage on the other Acolyte, because I really feel like the Patron play is what needs to be done here. What do you guys think?
I think Osaka's mind right now is running through if his opponent has combo.
Right.
And combo is an efficient way to deal with Grim Patron, right? This is really the only tools that Druid has. So he thinks he has it in his hand, he's just going to hold off, draw top deck the Battle Rage there and refill his hand to...
Yes, it's 25.
Cards, yeah.
25 points of health with the armor. If he armors up even more, he doesn't have to. He's absolutely safe beyond the combo range. And this board threatens to.
Yeah, Pimping Ho's face really says it all. He's like, all that armor. No, I didn't want him to get this much armor. But yeah. Osaka firmly in the driver's seat now, totally protected. There's really nothing Pimping Ho can pull out as the Druid player to do any kind of a significant threatening to Osaka's position.
Doomsayer, Robert, is it Doomsayer time?
Yeah, in bleak moments like this, then you just have to play Doomsayer.
Yeah, well, let's see what's driving the Shredder. I would be surprised if he doesn't go for that, because that's kind of what he needs to be doing right now.
Yeah, I mean, you take every chance you get, right? As slim as it might be, you know, sometimes it happens.
All right, so Bimiko is going for the combo to clear the minions. Now the sequence.
Oh wow, he's actually clearing it the hard way.
Well, so, that's obviously, it gives him the more, there's a way better probability of him winning the game clearing minions off the board, I think, than looking for a Doomsayer and a Shredder.
Time waits for no one.
Yeah, I'm not so sure about that, because Skaka will be sitting at, you know, 5 cards after the Accolade draws a card, so, you know, it might be hard to come back from that point. So, we'll see if it pays off for him.
Well, we do know now that there is a dog somehow driving a Shredder.
This one, Armorsmith, survived for so many turns.
Yep.
MVP, well, I wish we could see the damage that has been tallied up by that Armorsmith.
All right,
damage
guys.
And then the HP generated.
This is it. Romash Skaka is going to seal the game number one and take it from Pimping Hell. So Skaka is 1-0, second match.
Yeah, and that run really came down to Skaka making all the right decisions when he needed to, understanding what his win conditions were, even at points kind of deciding towards the end there, I just need to get to more cards, I'll get to more cards and I'll find my answer. I don't necessarily need to make a bunch of patrons, so good on Skaka. And for Pimping Ho, I'm sure he's going to look back at that turn where he chose not to clear the Armorsmith
right.
And maybe rethink that one, like, was that something I should have done? Was I okay with that play?
Yeah, that Armorsmith, at the end of the day, gained so much armor that, you know, Oskar just went out of reach from Pimping Ho. And of course, like you said, Robert, the two-patron play on turn 5 was very impressive. Usually you just want to, you know, get as many patrons as you can, but, you know, Oskar realizes that, you know, 2 is fine against the matchup.
Yeah, but on the other hand, like, the matchup was in favor of Skaka, so just using the cards that were in his deck, he was able to set up a really good control and win in the end. Cards like Battle Rage were really useful. The fact how he was using Inner Rages to draw the cards as well, to set up to draw into Grommash and Whirlwind, he knew exactly what he had in his deck and what was left, so a pretty impressive game.
Yep, very well played by Skaka, so.
All right, so what do you guys think is gonna be the next choice of the decks for those guys?
It's hard to guess at this moment, but Skaka really favors Freeze Mage, though. We'll see if he goes with that next.
All right. Well, we have we sat down with Pimping Ho to see what he has to say, so let's check that out.
My name is Pingping Ho, I'm 28 years old, and I'm representing Taiwan. Because we don't have our own tournament in Taiwan, we have to participate in tournament in Europe or NA. Basically, we have our daily schedule completely upside down. We sleep at day and play Hearthstone tournament at night. The first tournament that I won was Intel Cyber League in Taiwan. I wasn't even going to participate in that day, but they told me there was a space open for me, and I just joined it and won it by accident. One of the biggest obstacles I have this year is my team White Spider was disbanded a couple of months ago. I got a really good teammate, Roger, team manager Mao Mao. If they have just sponsored me for a couple more months, I would have represent White Spider here at BlizzCon. A lot of people think Shaman is really bad, and they always laugh at me if I lose with my Shaman. They think Shaman is not a good class. When people told me that I should not bring Shaman to BlizzCon, I actually feel pretty exalted because I play Shaman so much, and I know Shaman so much more about than they do. If I win BlizzCon, I think Blizzard should add a new Shaman skin featuring Pingping Ho myself. Many Taiwanese fan doesn't want to support me, but I still make it here at BlizzCon Top 8. And I'll prove to them I'm good. 对各位支持我的粉丝呢，我很感谢各位大家的支持。至于那些不支持我的粉丝呢，我也还是要感谢你，因为你们给予我的负面能量一直是我向前的动力。
You just gotta love Pingping Ho. He's such a great guy, right?
Yeah, The positive energy for him really has been infectious. And, you know, a lot of times when you come into Hearthstone tournaments, it's easy to see players you don't recognize, and you're like, I don't necessarily feel like a strong attachment to this player, or, you know, they're not saying anything that's super resonating with me. But Pimping Ho, the whole shaman roleplay, being super confident, the being undaunted in the face of, you know, as he said, people laughing at him when he loses with shaman, very, very interesting individual, and one you can't help but root for.
He's proving himself, and Amaz, what do you think about him winning a tournament by accident?
Oh, I mean, I don't think it's an accident. I just think he's very humble. He's a really good player. That's why he's here in the top eight, and we're sitting here. So I'm really looking forward to seeing a shaman play, and looking forward to seeing the shaman skin as well.
Oh, absolutely.
He, you know, wins the whole thing.
I hope we actually edit it at some point.
Yeah.
I was gonna say, I'm pretty sure at this point Thrall's actually just an alternate skin for Pimping Ho.
Oh wow.
So, Pimping Ho is the default shaman hero.
That might be the case. But here we see the tables have turned. Oskaka is gonna play the Freeze Mage, and Pimping Ho is gonna cue the Druid again. And we know that Druid is a little bit of a favorite, you know, against the Freeze Mage.
I think this game might decide the whole match, because looking at the lineups, Freeze Mage might struggle versus Druid, might struggle versus Hybrid Hunter that Pimping Ho is bringing, and versus Shaman as well. For Oskaka, the best shot with the Freeze Mage is to actually get the Shaman, but here he got the Druid, and as you mentioned, Druid is actually favored.
I want to point out, though, you know, you say, like, oh, he would want to get Shaman into Freeze Mage, but Pimping Ho is no stranger to beating Freeze Mage with Shaman, so...
Absolutely. So it's not a great matchup for Oskaka as well.
Right.
Oskaka really needs to win at least one game with that Freeze Mage. So what do you guys think Oskaka needs to get to win versus Druid?
I mean, Oskaka's hand is looking pretty good, right? You really want to not see any secrets. You only want to see them from your mad scientist. You want the early draw engines like Loot Hoarder, like Acolyte of Pain that he has right now. And anytime Oskaka gets a Frost Nova, he can just Frost Nova and Doomsayer. Of course, Keeper of the Grove is kind of like the trump card from the Druid, but you have two right now. And he can even play both of the Doomsayers without a Frost Nova, and Druid sometimes struggle to deal 14 damage.
Right, and we see Oskaka's opening hand obviously has a lot of Doom in it. There's a lot of Doom going on in that hand, but there's also some upside. There's Loot Hoarder. Loot Hoarder and Acolyte of Pain are kind of low mana minions that you can put on the board. They can kind of jockey for position on the board. And more importantly, Pimping Ho has to deal with them as opposed to hitting, you know, Oskaka in the face, which, as a Freeze Mage, the longer you can keep the Druid distracted before it starts comboing you, starts playing those mid-range minions into your face, the better off you're ultimately going
to
be.
Yeah, you just want to chip the armor as well, because Druid can armor up later in the game, which makes the combo pretty hard. If you have 15 damage exactly, and Druid is like 15 plus 3 armor.
And Pimping Ho's hand is pretty awkward right now. You don't really want to innervate the Keeper of the Grove. You want to keep it for silencing a Doomsayer, or you want to silence off a frozen minion for that extra burst damage that your opponent does not expect. So I expect the hero power here and just, you know, save his cards.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's good to take his time. He has the time and he can think about future turns as well. It's not maybe about playing, innervating anything this turn. It's all about planning the game and mapping the matchup. What do they really want to play on turn 6 or 7 versus this deck?
And even if Pimping Ho goes into the next turn and uses that Innervate, Lothab is not really something against a Freeze Mage you just want to throw down. You want to use it on very specific turns to try to block out reapplication of secrets, try to block out possibly lethal damage. A lot of times it actually serves as the precursor to Alexstrasza in the late game, because Lothab comes out and you're like, all right, I'm just going to play my Giant Dragon.
Right. But unfortunately for Pimping Ho here, oh wow, the second Innervate actually opens the possibility of
Lothab.
The Ancient Floor. Instead of Lothab. Once again, Lothab is one of those key cards you want to disrupt the Freeze Mage.
All right, you want Ancient of Lore, Nimsh wants Lothab. I say we compromise and then you do Lothab Hero Power.
Wow.
Yeah.
Lothab Hero Power.
Because look, I mean, you're putting down a 5-5. You killed a Loot Hoarder.
Oh, man.
That's basic Hearthstone right there. You have killed the minion and you have played your own minion and you are well on your way to success.
That's really tricky, because I agree that Ancient of Lore is a bit better here and you want to keep Lothab, but on the other hand, what is your follow-up? So if you innervate Ancient of Lore here, you will have the Keeper on 4, but then you don't exactly keep her.
Well, no, the thing is, like, you draw 2 cards. I mean, the possibility of drawing, like, a Shredder or even a Wrath, something you can use, is pretty high, right? You're drawing a total of 3 cards and just by the start of your next turn. And Pimping Ho's gonna decide to do that, since his hand quality is, to be honest, quite weak.
Right. Yeah, reactive cards mostly, and cards he doesn't want to play.
And, you know, we're joking around a little bit about what he could have done on that turn, but obviously a world where you play a 5-5 and you draw 2 cards is a pretty good turn 3.
Right, and using an Innervate as a Moonfire doesn't seem like the best steal.
I mean, when you look at it like that, yeah, it's not so great when you call it a Moonfire.
Oh.
In my world, where it was just a hero power, it felt better.
But this means also that it's great news for Oskaka, because Innervate is out of the way. He knows that now Druid will have to use the standard rules of mana gains. And also he knows
what
that Pimpingo's hand maybe wasn't the best after seeing a hero power and then double innervating off Ashes of Glory.
So this is, when we look at Uzkaka's hand, obviously he's got that Acolyte of Pain, which he can possibly look at putting down in the next couple turns, start pinging that to draw cards, but the rest of his hand is just designed to get rid of minions.
Oh man, the second swipe is not really good for Pimpingo. He wanted that Shredder, as Amaz said, and swiping face doesn't seem good, so it might actually be Shapeshift. Just the hero power, deal one, get one armor. And in this matchup, armor is actually pretty good.
All right, so in the cardinal rules of Druid, you never just play out a Keeper of the Grove and hit him in the face unless you're about to kill him, right? So okay. Otherwise, that's just not a play you would make. You're Pimpingo, you're on turn four, you're out of innervates, you know this. You have to start getting the pressure rolling, you have to put something on the board. Is there a world where you consider this turn just Keeper of the Grove in the face?
Sometimes you could. I mean, if you're feeling like you really want to, you know, deal that 2 damage and make your Keeper of the Grove kind of like a Stormwind Knight, you know, put on the race. But at the same time, Uzkaka is at 29 health, so
yeah,
that doesn't really make sense.
Keeper is not only useful to deal with the Doomsayer, but even if your board is frozen and Mage thinks like he's safe, you can actually unfreeze one of your minions and attack with it.
Right, exactly.
The end is coming!
The end is coming now, and this actually is going to block Pimpingo from playing a minion.
I really like this play. Uzkaka playing a preemptive Doomsayer. He's seen that Pimpingo doesn't have a turn 4 play, and he is expecting something on turn 5, which means that do you really silence it right now?
Yeah, silencing feels really bad. It basically means that you're playing a 4-mana 2-4 with no Battlecry, since the Doomsayer is basically, you know, it just kills itself if you just leave it be. Pimpingo could also choose the Wild Growth here. He can play the Ancient of Lore on the following turn, but then both of his Ancient of Lores are also gone. So Uzkaka has more information and go like, yeah, you don't have any more healing that's available in your deck. So Pimpingo does decide to, you know, put some semblance of board pressure.
I'm sure he's just happy to be able to play that Keeper of the Grove and not have to do 2 damage to the face. It feels better to silence a minion.
Oh yeah, it does feel better to actually get some board control.
I use the minion correctly. This is what it's supposed to do.
Well, it is some board, and for Druid, if this Keeper stays alive, he will be able to deal at least some damage, and later in the game with Savage Lore, it might be deciding.
Right, and we see here now, obviously anytime you get your spells discounted, it's a win. You want them to cost less. It allows you to be more flexible with your hand, but this isn't really the sort of hand I think you would want Emperor Thorazin affecting.
Right, exactly. Pimpingo doesn't know that. Pimpingo thinks that, oh no, my opponent just got 6 card discounted. Yeah. I need to definitely get rid of this Thorazin until it gets it even more cheaper. So he's just gonna play the swipe. Unfortunately, he can't develop any minions. This is one of the drawbacks of Druid. You either play a spell or play a minion.
One spell at a time. And at this point, he is really behind. Mage has enough time to play the cards, to draw whatever he wants. He still has the draw opportunities with the Acolyte of Pain and Loot Quarter as well. And you know, even though he didn't exactly hit the cards he wanted, he still hit the cards that are all right. He will be able to draw those other cards.
Mind if I roll me?
Right, and something that it might not necessarily be a factor in the game, but it could become one, is the fact that Pimpingo chose to silence the Doomsayer does mean there's just an 0-6 on the board. So if Dr. Boom comes down, it could be something that possibly soaks up Boombot damage, and Boombots against Freeze Mage are actually a very important consideration, I feel like.
Yeah, you're right, because Boombots, sometimes Freeze Mage just needs to clear minions on their turn.
Right.
And when it's your turn, Secrets don't activate. So if Boombots hit you when you have an Ice Block up, when you're 1 health, you actually die.
Even if you have an Ice Barrier set up, maybe Boombots will actually kill you even though the Ice Barrier is there.
Right, but good guy Doomsayer's there, he's willing to help out. There's nothing else to do since, you know,
yeah, catch
some
bombs, right?
Yeah.
There you go.
It's like, hey, I'll help out. His arms are outstretched in the drawing, so it makes sense.
So a trivia question, Robert. Do you know what Doomsayer says when he attacks?
Did I miss it?
Nice.
Oh.
Yeah, see, okay, I know this one.
Hey. You know this one.
Amaz has been over the past few days questioning my Jeff Marino knowledge, and he's actually mostly correct. Okay. My Jeff Marino knowledge is nowhere close to Ben Brode's, but I do know something.
Impressive.
You didn't miss this one.
No, I did not miss this one. We see the Drake come down, hero power, you get rid of the Loot Hoarder, and Pimpingo's just trying to get a foothold on the board. But it's real not friendly for him.
Yeah, he missed 2 damage you know, to the face of the Keeper silencing the Doomsayer, so he feels like he had to attack the face there to get it back.
Uzkaka still doesn't have the combo cards, because how he's gonna win is gonna set up a nice block and play Alexstrasza, reduce Pimpingo's health to 15, and then win with Fireballs, Frostbolts, or just finishers. Yes. For now, he has all the ways to stall. give himself a bit more time to pick up those combo cards that I've just mentioned.
Yeah, he pretty much frees the board for 4 turns straight if he wants to.
All right.
So not really a rush for Osaka. And for Pippingho, when we look at his hand, it's not like there's any super... There's no play that just screams out at you, right? Like, maybe next turn you're just going to draw some more cards. You could play down a Shredder if you wanted to, but because he spent so many turns not having a really good play or being forced to just react to something like Emperor Thor's hand, Osaka's firmly in the driver's seat now.
Absolutely. Osaka also not threatened by combo next turn. Even double innervate is out, so he still decides to freeze the minions here. So, Amas, can you explain why?
Well, I'm actually very curious about this play. I'm not a freeze mage player, like a specialist at all myself. So, I wonder what Osaka is thinking. He didn't drop the Doomsayer. He feels like he might want to bait out the second keeper on his Mad Scientist, perhaps, before having the Doomsayer Frost Nova combo. And here, Pippingho doesn't really feel like he wants to use the Lotheb. The best turn to use Lotheb is usually the turn where Mage is 7 mana. Because at 8 mana, the Mage can actually just Frost Nova again and completely negate the Lotheb. And that's exactly what Pippingho was thinking. He's going to drop Double Shredder, put a bigger board, and it's back to Osaka here.
He's expecting Flame Strike.
I actually don't mind Frost Nova-ing that last play. You basically spent 2 mana to gain 6 health because you weren't getting attacked. And that feels fine to me. I think, especially considering the contents of his hand, he had so many freezes.
Yeah.
It's one of those things where if you're going to be drawing more cards, you might even need to make room for more of your burn spells you're looking for, your Alexstrasza, your Archmage Antonitis.
Absolutely, you still have Acolyte on board as well. He knew that he's drawing these 2 cards.
So I don't necessarily mind that so much. And yeah, Pippingho, just like that, you know, takes a turn and two Shredders on board represents so much potential power.
And I do like using the Blizzard here, since Blizzards is actually very, very expensive to cast. And you want to get it out of your hand. Oh, Skuka's just gonna go for the face here. Gonna bluff a little bit of damage that's not necessarily in his hand right now.
I love Living Roots in the deck. I love Living Roots as a new addition to the Druid because it messes up the math a bit. You expect, when you see Druid, you expect 14 points of damage coming. And with this Living Roots with 10 mana, it's actually 16. So you sometimes you try to keep yourself at 15 to be above the combo range, then bam, you're dead.
It's also just in general an extremely flexible card. It's great against aggro decks. You can use it to start pushing your own aggressive agenda if you're playing that more aggressive or into Druid we've seen a lot of on ladder. So it's definitely a very flexible card, which fits perfectly with the mindset of Druid, which is having a lot of options on their turns.
All right, so Pippingho here, he has combo available, but it doesn't seem like a combo turn. Do we know if there are any secrets? No secrets yet.
There's no secrets.
I don't really mind the Lotheb too much here. It seems like Otsuka is setting a turn where he's going to pop the Shredders and perhaps play a Flame Strike or something. And now that Lotheb is down, it actually prevents Otsuka from playing any damage board clears. He can still play the Frost Nova, but he cannot clear the board this turn.
It's always disruptive to play against Freeze Mage, unless there's Alexstrasza, but
it's true.
If Alexstrasza is played now, then Osaka realizes he's probably dead.
Yeah,
he does some trades in with the Mad Scientist here to set up the block, but...
And not only that, he doesn't even have the damage to finish out his opponent if he does cast Alexstrasza. And at the end of the day, Alexstrasza is only dealing 7 damage right now.
This is actually why this matchup tends to swing so heavily into the Druid's favor, because early game, fine, you've got the board, you're putting down small minions, you're good, you're kind of fighting for the board a little bit with Loot Hoarders and Acolytes of Pain, Mad Scientist, but once you get into the mid game as the Freeze Mage, you're not really playing minions anymore. You're not playing anything that just contests the board, and you basically go into this purely reactive mode, where all you're doing is answering the board every single turn, and if you don't have the right answers when you need them, then a lot of times things go very poorly for you, and Druid, more than any other class, puts out so much mid-range pressure.
So just the Frost Nova, he had the Doomsayer available as well, but he knows there is the Blizzard, dealing with one Shredder at a time. He's preparing for that Blizzard next turn. He still needs the burn. So if he uses Blizzard next turn, he'll be able to rank an intellect to get those burn spells. Double Fireball, and he'll be in a great spot.
Right, and we saw when Pippingho saw the Frost Nova come out, he kind of shook his head like that was the one spell he was maybe hoping to dodge. Because as you pointed out, it was really the only thing. He'd already seen one. It was the only thing Osaka could have played to stop the board from doing anything the next turn, so Pippingho did not want to see that, and it kind of countered, I think, what the intended desire of his Lotheb was.
Yeah, Lotheb at this point was kind of useless.
Yeah, well, it's a 5-5. You had to give yourself the opportunity to make Osaka have that. And since Osaka did have that, you know, great for Osaka, but Pippingho, I think that was a pretty reasonable play and gave him an opportunity to just win the game on the next turn.
Robert, do you see good way for Pimpico to win. We know what the Skunk is trying to do. Skunk is trying to join with burn spells. He did set up the secret, so now he can slam Alexstrasza. If he picks one of the burn spells, he'll be in a good spot. Like, he has the second ice block, so he has time to deal that damage. What Pimpinho has to draw or do to win this game from this point?
I think if you're Pimpinho as the druid here, all you do is you just keep putting down minions. You keep forcing him after responses, and then the turn he doesn't have a response, you just kill him.
Yeah, exactly. And you also have the Ancient of Lore for backup healing, even if the Alexstrasza comes down, to see if you can push away from the threshold of dying.
I like that Pimpinho's held onto that for as long as he's had, because obviously he's had the opportunity to use it and draw cards, which is usually what you want to do with Ancient of Lore, but understanding how Freeze Mage beats you, I've drawn enough cards, I have a bunch of cards in hand already, I'll just save this as a heal, which I'm sure is going through his head.
Still a pretty tricky board for Oskaka to deal with here. He could choose to use Alexstrasza like we mentioned. He could also, decide to draw some cards, perhaps fish for the Flame Strike, but here he's just going to, freeze the board. Oh man, mana! Pillow's mana store! Oh man.
He's always in the Shredder you least expect him.
Exactly.
Important to note, Oskaka did get Archmage Antonitis last turn.
Right.
So Archmage Antonitis will allow him to start chaining low mana spells such as Frostbolt, Ice Lance, start putting a whole bunch of fireballs in his hands, and then over a couple of turns, use Alexstrasza, and then look to kill out his opponent from there.
Exactly. Maybe he doesn't even need Alexstrasza at this point. With Antonitis, he might just slam Antonitis, go with the Frostbolt, Ice Lance, get two fireballs, deal 7 damage.
Right.
And he knows double Ancient of Lore. Oh, he actually seen one Ancient of Lore, so he expects the second one is somewhere there.
Right.
Yeah, you bring up a good point. Alexstrasza is actually not super relevant in terms of just doing raw damage to Pimpinho. Pimpinho's already at 21, and Alexstrasza would just bring him to 15 health, and he would still keep the armor, so not necessarily super relevant at the moment. It might just be easier, as you said, to go the route where you just try to win through Archmage Antonitis.
Yeah, also, the second Ice Block will be really important for Skaka, because then he can maybe Fireball, Ice Block, gain one more turn, and if he picks one of the normal Fireballs, and he will have one more because of the Antonitis.
Yeah. At the end of the day, Pimpinho just realizes that his hero power is the most important thing that he needs to, keep using over and over again.
Oh.
And that Flame Strike is going to clear the board.
Yeah, this means the board is cleared, as you said, 28 points of health. Dr. Boom, but 28 is a lot.
What a rough time to be Milhouse Mana Storm. You pop out of the shredder, you get frozen, then you immediately just get Flame Strike. Like, why all the gnome hate? Jeez.
Yeah, there you go. Milho's Mana Storm might not perhaps been the best 2-mana drop. Something with a Death Rattle might have been better. But like you said, Robert, this Doomsayer might be catching some bombs.
Yeah, let's see how much work he's willing to put in. How good is this Doomsayer? How good is it?
This Doomsayer, 0-5 silenced.
Yeah, how much football does he play? Is he used to, catching a lot of bombs?
I think it's fine. The problem is there's 2 bombs. And Savager and a combo is a lot of damage, and you don't want to get your Ice Block destroyed.
It's really just a counting game here. Oskaka's thinking, how many turns do I need to kill Pimpinho?
Right.
And he also needs to factor in every turn he needs to, set up the combo is one more armor for Pimpinho. So Oskaka here is just going to, remove the Dr. Broom.
Yep, generate 2 fireballs. Yeah, I was thinking about this. This is actually just, when you look at his hand, I think the best play. This keeps him safe, I believe, from dying to combo or popping the block even.
Right.
A little bit of math here, but.
Oh, second Savage Robot, double Innervate was already used.
Oh yeah, the more I look at this play, the better I feel about it, because now the Druid has to deal with Antonitis. You can't just leave it around.
Right? Yeah.
Druid actually doesn't, compared to other classes, really doesn't have convenient answers. They obviously have Keeper of the Grove, which I believe seen one of now. I don't know if he's seen the second, but he's seen one.
What?
And there is nothing like a sap. There's nothing, like an execute. So the Druid has to play it very fairly to try to get rid of Archmage Antonitis.
So Pimpinho has a couple of options. He can use Force of Nature and one of the bombs to clear. He can use Savage Roar and attack it with the face if the bombs don't hit it. If he just uses Savage, he will be able to play Ancient of Lore or Azure Drake. So this means if he decides for that play, he can probably draw first, just in case.
Or he can just hit both of the Boom Boss to Antonitis and kill it.
Yeah, that's a valid. Yeah, absolutely.
That happens a lot.
I don't like to talk about the senseless crime committed against Azure Drake.
Okay.
It just hurts my heart.
So let's see where the Boom Boss hits here, and that goes to the face.
There we
and
go.
No!
Wow.
And that's really important because now he's going to take that 5 damage from Antonitis.
Not only that, it's going to remove all his armor. And Pimpinho is sitting at 19 health.
And there is an Ice Block and Alexstrasza.
Let's see, obviously he doesn't have a way to Okay, so there's no way he kills him this turn.
Right.
Might just be okay to Alexstrasza.
Yeah, sure, you put an 8 on the board.
And you deal 4 damage.
I mean, you could dig deeper into your deck with Arcane Intellect, which is what he's ultimately going to do, but at that point, I'm not really sure what you're looking for aside from more burn, which is actually pretty reasonable.
A Fireball and a Thalnos. Yeah. I like it. You can actually use Thalnos for double Fireball next turn.
Right, and so the Fireball face here does set up lethal.
It also telegraphs that you're going for lethal. Right. It tells him straight up, hey, I have enough damage to kill you now, so we're going to start throwing Fireballs. So it might trigger the Ancient of Lore to come out.
And then you use Alexstrasza.
Right.
Yeah, that might happen.
Yeah.
Pretty interesting dynamic.
Yeah, Alexstrasza will be a good counter to Ancient of Lore. You put a 5-5, they put an 8-8.
Yeah, looking at this hand from Oskaka, I think the Ice Lance is actually just a dead card now. Oskaka already used double Frostbolts, so all his damage is from minions and from the 2 Fireballs.
It's also important to note, this is a very minor thing, but Oskaka chose to use the Fireball, though, one of the Fireballs that was created by Antonidas, because it doesn't necessarily reveal that he has more Fireballs. So
yeah, exactly.
Obviously, Pimping Ho probably suspects them. But when I play this matchup on ladder, it's usually one of those things where I try to remember to use the Fireball so that, you know, I'm not just saying, like, I do have 3 to 4 Fireballs.
Sure, information is key. And wow, Oskaka is actually down to 1 card.
1 last card. This means, like, he got that Fireball. Like, even if without the Fireball, he still had a great he was in a great shape because he's seen Lothlip, he's seen double Ancient Floor. Druid has no way to heal.
Oh.
Through all that Fireballs.
Double Fireball face.
Yeah, he pulls the trigger here. The hero power puts down Pimping Ho to 5. If he uses his own shapeshift, that would be 6. So he's dead to Fireball. He even has the Thalnos there.
And yeah, that's it. I don't think Pimping Ho can actually pop the block and kill his opponent. The fatigue damage does not set in next turn.
Right.
And Oskaka has his Fireball, so Pimping Ho is going to drop a game here.
It would have been really tempting for Oskaka too to play down this, maybe something like Blood Mage Thalnos, because just strictly speaking, more damage than the hero power. But as you pointed out, then it interacts with fatigue in a way that could have potentially been problematic for him. So he just realizes he doesn't need it, he has enough damage. And this is why when I say Oskaka is such a good technical player, this is what I'm talking about. Like, you fall into these habits sometimes when playing Hearthstone where you're like, oh, I just want to do more damage. That's what I'm doing. And, you know, he understood exactly how much damage he needed, did not put himself in any kind of problematic situation. He's going to go up 2-0 in the series as a result of this incredibly intelligent play.
And that was such an important win because the Freeze Mage was supposed to have a bad matchup versus the whole lineup from Pimping Ho, and now he secured a win. He's down to his Oil Rogue, and he only needs to win one game. He has 3 chances to do it.
And that's, honestly, that matchup, it cannot be overstated. It's so incredibly difficult for the Freeze Mage, so very, very, just super good play from Oskaka, and here he is, one game away from advancing.
Yeah, it was very impressive. There was a point where Pimping Ho had, you know, 5 or 6 minions even on the board, and, you know, Oskaka just find a way to deal with all of them while still not fatiguing and destroying his opponent at the same time.
Absolutely. So guys, being Pimping Ho, what do you think you bring this time? You know Oskaka is going to bring Rogue. What will be the best matchup?
I'm going with Hunter.
You're going with Hunter?
Oh, yeah.
Well, okay, at the end of the day, it doesn't matter, right?
Right.
So I think you just need to bring out the Shaman now, you know, get the confidence back at your side.
Sure, that's actually, you know what, I'm going to change my answer. I like that. You are the Shaman. It is time. This could potentially be your last game if you lose. You want to play that Shaman, so.
Yeah.
Yep.
And he did say that Elements are going to destroy Oskaka.
Yeah.
So we heard a lot from Pimping Ho. We've seen an interview with him. What I want to see and what I want to hear is Oskaka saying about what he thinks about this match.
When I was younger, I moved around a lot. I've lived in Miami, New York, Indonesia, and Mexico City. I think I attended like 6 different schools. Most of them were international, some Swedish. And it's really been quite an experience. You know, I've always had to sort of adapt to other people and their sort of lifestyle. And yeah, it's looking back on it, it's been a really good experience. So when I was playing competitive soccer, it was really more just for fun. Of course, I spent a lot of time and, you know, put a lot of effort into it. It sort of came naturally as well. Like, I mean, I was not only playing soccer like during the evening, but also like all the time during the day, on all the breaks, balancing school and soccer practice. Of course, you know, it's a lot of time you have to put into it, and you don't have a lot of time for other stuff. And so it's actually quite similar to like my Hearthstone schedule right now. I'm just, you know, trying to balance everything, you know, the practice and, you know, actually sleeping and eating and everything, just balancing it all. usually whenever there's a camera on me or even just a microphone, I usually get quite nervous. And, you know, as soon as like my heart rate increases, it's just not as comfortable as if I'm sitting at home playing. So I tend to rely a little bit more on instincts when I'm playing in tournaments. And it's usually not that good, but, you know, so far I think I've been playing pretty on point. So I think it's fine. My youngest brother is 13 years old. His name's William. He goes to school in Sweden. He's really cool in supporting me and all this gaming stuff. And my older brother, Marcus, he lives in London. He's 22. I give my little brother some deck lists every now and then. He may ask me about the game. Of course, I'm like really willing to help him. Of course, it's fun for me as well. But it's mostly about like the time. I don't always have time for everything. At first, my parents were not like that supportive. I mean, they weren't really sure how serious it was. And of course, as I was growing up, you know, it was always your job to, you know, sort of tell me to stop playing and, you know, do my homework and whatever. But as soon as I started, you know, actually making money off of this and I was like, really good at it, you know, they started respecting it. So my parents are actually just figuring out Twitch and, you know, it's really cool for them. It's like I'm watching TV, you know, I'm playing the World Championships and they think it's really, really cool that I'm on this huge stage in front of so many viewers. I actually had a lot of preparation going into this event and I always had my teammates practicing with me, you know, the whole way around. They were always, you know, questioning my deck choices and everything. And so I really had my teammates there the whole time preparing with me. If I were to give advice to an upcoming pro player, I'd say that just keep practicing, keep playing, preferably the same deck, and it's like a high skill deck as well. Just keep playing it until you can sort of perfect it, and then look into playing tournaments and showing what you're worth. I really like the game. It's really like just endless amounts of skill that you can put into it, and at the same time, I'm of course really good at it, so it's really fun.
It's so great that family supports Skaka.
Yeah, I was going to say, that's kind of one of the reoccurring storylines I feel like we've seen all throughout the championship, regardless of region, is players getting into Hearthstone very seriously, making a real go at an esports career, parents not necessarily being with it in the beginning, and then coming to kind of understand like how it actually can be a career and how it's something that these players are very passionate about and kind of how esports as a whole is becoming more mainstream. And it's really cool to see.
Yeah, absolutely. The support. Amaz, do you have the support as well?
Yeah, I guess so. My dad says, you know, it's cool what you do. Keep doing it. And then I was like, oh, do you know understand the game at all? I was like, nah, but you're cool. That's all it needs, right?
That's really important. But I think what's the most impressive about Skaka is that he's practicing so much. And I was talking to him, is he getting nervous when he plays on the big stage? He said, yes, I'm really nervous. Right. But the fact that I practice so much is that when I make a play by default, it's actually the correct play.
Yeah, he's doing really good. If he's nervous, I certainly can't see it now. He's up 2-0. He only needs that one game to advance to the semifinals against Tice. But, you know, on the other hand, we can't count Pippin Ho out. You know, he's a very good player. He didn't get into the stage by accident at all. And he's going to bring out his, you know, fairly interesting hybrid hunter against Ozkaka.
So the first pick, that this is what you, Robert, suggested. Why would you take Hunter versus Rogue?
In my experience playing against Rogue on Ladder, obviously I haven't played Hunter much this month, but in prior months I played a fair bit of it, and I feel like the Rogue kind of has to have very specific answers to what you're doing at that moment, and then if it doesn't have it, you just run them over. And what's a good counter to Rogue and all their hijinks? Just killing them with your bow.
Yeah, absolutely. A very fast counter is really good, especially with Fell Reavers, a card when it's being dropped, you have to... You just sap it, like, killing it is so much damage, and Rogue has only a limited amount of damage to finish his opponent.
Yeah, sometimes a big creature that comes one turn before high main is just enough to deal with the Rogue. Ozkaka is going to decide whether he keeps these saps or not. It's going to be very good if he does, if he knows what Pimping Ho is doing here.
I was going to say, because he knows the lineup and he understands the deck list for Pimping Ho, it's something where, like, as a Rogue, you normally don't want to keep Sap.
Right.
You just don't want to.
Job's done.
But against Pimping Ho, we saw him really consider, he's like, I could just win the game right there if I just put the Fell Reaver back in the hand. But
yeah.
Opts not to keep it. Pimping Ho does, however, keep Fell Reaver, which is a very, very strong card, especially if he can follow it up with a turn 6 Savannah Hyman. That represents so much damage coming in each turn.
Yeah, but before he does that, he actually needs the minions for the first turns. He has the Juggler, he is missing the one drop. And he's missing the free drop. Unleash the Hounds. Oh, Animal Companion actually will help a lot with this curve.
Yeah, this is suddenly a way better curve. If he could just come into something like a Shredder, he would really... The hand would basically just kind of play itself at that
exactly.
point.
Exactly. But right now, turn 2... playing a turn 2 juggler against a Rogue never feels good.
No.
They have Coin SI7, they have Backstab, they have Deadly Poison. It's not going to live. But at the same time, you still need to play something. You need your opponent to expend their resources. If you just hear a Power Pass, they can just do anything they want.
All right,
including those stuff.
question for you guys. Which is it scary to play a knife juggler against, a rogue or a druid?
Rogue.
You think so?
There you go. More answers, right? Backstab. It's a very, very simple answer.
Fair. That's straightforward. I personally am more afraid of the druid, but that's just because I feel like I've seen so many druids when I play Hunter.
Well, the thing with the opening weekend that we saw on BlizzCon Top 16 is that 100% of the knife jugglers that were played on turn 2 just got sniped by the Innervate Keeper to Grove. So that might have skewed your opinion about it.
I was going to say, much like Milhouse Mana Storm, knife juggler, another gnome, doesn't really have a long lifespan. It usually lives about a third of a turn before it is brutally murdered by either Keeper of the Grove or a backstab or a stiff breeze.
Do you like gnomes, Robert?
I actually really feel for gnomes. I mean, not being necessarily super tall myself, I feel like I kind of relate to them, and I just don't understand why, you know, they're picked on so much.
You should avoid World of Warcraft. There's a quest when you're a ball of fire and just rush the gnomes.
Oh, I just play Orc Hunters there, so no problem.
There you go.
Good. All right, guys, just touching up on Oskaka's hand. He's debating what to do with that jungler if there's any merit from stabbing it. He decides to go for that exactly. I think it's really good for him that he got the coin. He's by the teacher as well. It doesn't seem that he got that deadly poison, which is really good in the beginning, but he is a fan of knives and played flurry, so he has some AoE possibilities here.
He probably played down the Thalnos because it puts a 1-1 on the board that's going to help him draw a card, but I like to think it was a statement just to overkill the Leopard Gnome. He didn't need to do 3 damage. He chose to do 3 damage.
All right. Well, the thing in the end of the day is that hunters have a really hard time dealing with a 1-health creature efficiently. Yep. You don't want to blow it down.
Quick shot.
You don't want to do any of those. So
that's that one point where you're like, quick shot, why aren't you a better hero power? Where most of the time you love quick shot. Mm-hmm. Or steady shot, rather, but.
All right, so Pimpico actually got the Yawk and picked up Haunted Creeper. Haunted Creeper will be helpful on turn 4 because he will be able to hero power. For Oskaka, it is a bit an awkward situation, I guess.
So
on the other hand, it's like Eviscerate is free damage. He has that hero. He has that Thalnos up.
Wow. I think that would. Imagine if that turn, if he had had a prep, so he could have just, you know, Violet Teacher prep the Eviscerate. So.
Yeah, or imagine if the Anim Companion was a Huffer. It would actually work out for Oskaka even better. We joke that, you know, Huffer might always be the best animal companion, but not in that case.
Right, that's obviously an overplayed joke that you always want to get Huffer off animal companion, and we love doing it to Jask because we just enjoy talking about Huffer, but there are a lot of circumstances where you'd rather have Misha, circumstances where you'd rather have Leok. So.
Especially if there's like a 2-1 on board, right. That's just going to kill Huffer.
So for Pimpico here, he's not really presenting the biggest board, but that's kind of to be expected when you play against Rogue. Rogue is very good at clearing boards.
Pay attention, class!
So Skaka just going for the Violet Teacher to develop the biggest creature he has right now. His board is pretty good. It's so funny the Thalnos is still alive after all those turns.
Oh, this is such a dangerous turn for Pimpico, and I fully expect him to take the full turn timer. He can play Lotheb, and if you play Lotheb, you're blocking out Violet Teacher getting value from spells, and more important, it's the safe turn. If you play down that Fel Reaver and the sap comes out, I honestly believe you just lost the game.
Yeah, you just pass the turn 5 without doing anything, and your opponent has, 3 more mana to do whatever he wants. So Lothab does guarantee, more or less, that it's going to get some value.
It's really strong.
It's not even about the fact that the Fel Reaver would discard 3 cards before it's put back in hand. The Rogue, when the Rogue beats mid-range decks, it's off that tempo turn where they take a 5 or 6 mana minion, put it back in the hand with sap, and then continue to push their agenda from there, use the oils, look for the blades, Flurry, so I really like seeing the Lothab up there, and I think that's a very heads-up play from Pimpico.
Now, does the Skaka flow up with Lothab as well? Edwin can't really be comboed, so 2-2 Edwin is not great.
Exactly. The best combo to a Lothab is a Lothab yourself.
Yeah, absolutely. This means the Lothab from Pimpico still will have to attack into the 3-5, and your Lothab might be unused, unless they trade, but that's good for you. A 3-5 Valiant Teacher might provide you with a lot of minions, but then if you have a lot of minions, you have to think about Unleash the Hounds from the Hunter.
So anytime the Hunter trades with you, you'll usually take it. That's the Hunter trading is a great place to be in as the non-Hunter player.
I think Pimpico is just gonna. The Savanheim is looking really good right now. You know, make your board even more deadly, put more pressure on the board. Rogues can't really, you know, deal with that many creatures unless they have a big Blade Flurry. And Skoka seems like he's gonna have a little trouble here.
For the record, I think anytime there's a green border around Savannah Highway, I mean, it looks good.
Okay.
It doesn't even matter what turn, it's just a good looking card. Nice looking animal.
Oh, that's a fair statement.
Yeah.
Okay, so Pimpico decides to kill the Violet Teacher, not trade with Lothar. This helps him to get the board, and he guesses there is no AoE for now, no good way to deal with the board, but.
It's kind of like a mid-risk, high-reward play. You get rid of the Violet Teacher, so that's good. And you're going to hope, basically, that you force either additional resources or even that Lotheb to trade with your Lotheb. And there's not really a situation where you get overly hurt for it, I don't think. I don't know what you guys think of it.
If there is Final Knives and Late Flurry, you're really getting hurt. Because right now, Skaha has all the ways to just clear the board.
Yeah.
After Thingo's Kaka would like to, like I said, seen a prep by now. That would really allow him to kind of go crazy with a tempo turn, but especially with Edwin Van Cleef sitting in hand.
Yeah, with 6 mana right now, Oscar can't really doesn't have too many options. If he clears the board, he might have to use the Oil and the Flurry, which, well, he's deciding to do. Just play off the board and play the long game.
Other option was just going with the Fan of Knives, then attacking with the weapon into the spider and using Flurry as well.
That's true. But Ping Ping Ho has a surprise, which double surprise. There's going to be 2 Fell Reavers. Ping Ping Ho's going to perhaps even lose his whole deck.
Oh, he's thinking about it, because if he does this, and gosh, if he follows it up with another Fell Reaver on the following turn, it's one of those things where he doesn't really know if he's going to get to draw any more cards ever again, or if he's just going to immediately be playing in a position where all of his cards are being milled. But that's what's in his hand, it represents a lot of damage, and if Hoskaka doesn't have the sap, then Ping Ping Ho's in a good spot.
Yeah, at the end of the day, you just saw an Oil Blade Flurry, so Hoskaka's only way of dealing with this Fell Reaver is a sap. There's no more direct damage. And if there is even more direct damage, but Ping Ping Ho just has a second one. Doesn't really matter. That first one gets killed.
The big question is, as a Skaka, do you fish for sap with Azure Drake, which is a possibility, or do you just develop Violet Teacher and Edwin Van Cleef, putting 2 good minions on board, which means that if you mill more cards, but it's all about just tempting Hunter to trade with your minions to give yourself a bit more time.
Yeah, I mean, with Azure Drake, you would have missed the 3-5 if you missed the sap drop. Oh, man. Wow. You know, something with a Fell Reaver is like fish for the card you need for the next turn, you know?
Yeah.
That was just like watching
That's the advantage of the card, right?
Just mill all the bad cards.
Yeah. That to me was just like watching like the Price is Right spinner, like ding, 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 then just lands on Dr. Boomers.
Jackpot.
So much pain in my chest. It was hurt to watch, but...
right to the face. Hunter likes to go face.
I was going to say, it's not too many other... I don't think you trade at this point. It's clear he doesn't have sap, and that's really the only thing you're scared of. And yeah, Dr. Boom is going to put an extra... In case that Fall Reaver was not doing enough damage, here's Dr. Boom.
Well, he can get a secret. If he has something like an explosive chop, or even a freezing chop, it should be alright.
Yeah, of course.
Also limit the possibility of drawing a secret next turn.
It's not a sap, so Oskaka needs to find some other answers, and...
Well, he can use Azure Drake and Eviscerate and attack with a 3-5 into an 8-8.
Right, but then there is a trap, so at the end of the day, you're left with only a 4-4, and you know, Dr. Boom's just gonna crush Oskaka off the game.
Yeah, this is kind of the same reason why I feel like Oil Rogue has always fun, or even Tempo Rogue back in the day too, kind of struggled against Handlock because you have those 8-8 minions, which just requires so many resources to get through for the Rogue that it just becomes so problematic to actually push your own agenda.
Right,
after you use like your Eviscerates and your Oils, you don't really have enough gas in the tank to kind of get the win. So
yeah, a lot of players are actually scared of using the Fell Reaver because why would you want to lose cards from the deck? But at the end of the day, a 5 mana 8-8 has a lot of attack and a lot of health, so it's really hard to remove.
I'm very impressed with how much this Fell Reaver, not even in this series, but in prior series for Pippin Hill, has just done so much work.
Yeah.
Very very glad to see that this has not made its way to ladder yet. People are not running Fell Reaver and Hunter.
Fell Reaver is really good. It's also good in other decks, like Night Mage and Acrystic Druid as well.
Alright, Skaka is going to use the Eviscerate to clear one of these big guys. I prefer the Fell Reaver even.
And a minion attack?
Just too much damage.
So he's not dead yet, there's that 12 points of damage incoming.
That's a pretty good draw as well. You get another Fell Reaver and perhaps a Shredder.
Yeah, I like that play so much. Just keep putting power on the board, force Oskaka to have answers. Obviously, we know Oskaka's hand is extremely clunky.
Double sprints.
No Fell Reaver.
First the Hero Pirate. I mean, you are winning the game soon with Unleash the Hounds. That's even more burst damage. So I do like that play.
I was going to say, it's a little bit of risk management too.
That's true.
I think.
I think that was absolutely correct. You can even use the Hunt this turn to deal frequency damage.
Oh yeah, might as well.
This means that Oskaka has cleared the board and secured a win in some way because he's almost dead to the Hero Power next time.
Yeah.
I think if there was any chance, and I don't think there was one given what was in his hand, it would have had to have started with a prep, into the sprint, into find some kind of answer. He didn't even have the dagger up though, so that's... Anything he would have done to win the game or come back from that had to have started with a dagger, and he didn't have it prepped up, so.
Yeah, that's true. The only time Osaka saw his saps were at the start of the game where he mulliganed them. So
well,
perhaps,
he said he didn't want them.
Yeah.
And saps took that very personally. they're off somewhere like, huh, wouldn't it be nice if you could have just sapped that Fel Reaver?
Exactly.
Are you saying that he betrayed the saps or the saps betrayed Osaka?
Yeah, saps is still not here. But once again, there is the Doomsayer. There's always that possibility. It's a fire, but not that type.
And Osaka recognizes that as a loss. Ping Ping Ho still alive, winning game number three versus Osaka.
I like that. Like I said, I felt his Hunter had a very strong matchup, just did a ton of pressure, a lot of damage. So he's going to go ahead and come up into the series now. Obviously, he's still down two games as far as closing it out and winning it, but he gets that win. Looking at what he has left, Druid versus Shaman into Rogue. I feel like Rogue, everything we've seen suggests that the Shaman usually loses to the Rogue because of all his board clears, all the rapid tempo swings where Shaman already kind of has a weakness. So I'd like to see him go ahead and go with Druid as opposed to going to the mentality of, oh, I have to get the win with the Shaman anyway. Take it to five games.
Yeah, just go with the one that's most comfortable right now. You just won a game. You got your confidence boost a little bit up. So, just play your game and force Osaka to react to your place.
Yep.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm really curious to see that Shaman versus our Rogue, because many games I've seen Rogue actually falling to Shaman. If the Shaman is able to maintain the board control and pressure you with the cards like Fire Elemental, deal with your board, Shaman can take the game.
Sure.
All right, guys. We sat down with Osaka to ask him when he realized that he can go pro. So let's see what he has to say.
I actually picked up Hearthstone when I was still in school, but then I realized that I was actually doing quite well. You know, I was one of the best players, so I just decided to take a year off and then commit myself to playing Hearthstone, and it's worked out pretty well so far. So I'm not entirely decided on what I'm going to do in the future. Generally, in esports, you retire quite early from like your at least playing career, but of course, there's other ways to stay involved, like streaming or even working for esports companies. But I still haven't really gotten into any of that, so we will see what happens.
All right, guys, so this might be the last game. If Osaka wins with the Rogue, he advances. If Ping Ping Ho loses here, he's eliminated. But he's not out yet. He has his Druid deck and a trusty Shaman. He promised that elements are going to destroy Osaka. Will he deliver, Robert?
I mean, look, the elements are a very flexible thing. Maybe the elements are also like your Druid deck. It's kind of one of those things where it's in the fine print. There was an asterisk next to that statement you couldn't see. I feel like I would like to see him open up a Druid, but absolutely, him going to Shaman would not surprise me. He's confident in pretty much every match. Shaman has the edge because he's playing Shaman.
So. I'll be a little bit disappointed if he loses the series without playing Shaman. So whatever his strategy is, hopefully he can. Oh no, never mind. We're gonna see the Shaman right here and right now.
Finally, all right, guys. Game number four is starting right now. Skaga versus Ping Ping Ho, Rogue versus Shaman. Will the elements win?
I think the elements are going to want to have a pretty good early curve if they want to win. Okay. I would think they would want to look for Totem Golem, Tuskar Totemic.
Mm-hmm. Perhaps even the Creeper.
Yep, I was going to say the Haunted Creepers, very important. Anything sticky normally gives the Rogue a little bit of more problems than other minions traditionally do, in the same way it kind of does for Warrior. So really, any weapon-based class. I think that's what you want to be looking for. It's very tempting to keep a Manatite Totem, I think. I'm not sure I would, but it's one of those things I would give thought to. Because Shaman, having access to more cards and possibly getting one or two draws off of it is really big.
I think in the very beginning you want to have tempo as well. So you want to slam those dynamics when you get them. Mm-hmm. What are you looking for as a Skaka, Amaz?
Oh, as a Skaka, I'm just looking for minions early on. And, look for the minions that actually aren't 3 health. There are so many minions that Rogue runs that have 3 health. Earthen Ring Farseer, SI7 Agent, and Shredder. Why that is because they just die to everything that's 3 from the Shaman. You die to like Rockbiter, you die to Flame Tongue Totem plus a 1-1. There's just such efficient ways for Shamans to deal 3 damage. So the Violet Teacher is going to be amazing for Osaka here.
Yeah, it looks pretty good. So looking at both hands, I think Osaka has really nice head, not only because of Violet Teacher, but Preparation Sprint looks good as well. Coin is always good for Rogue. And on the Ping Ping Ho side, well, he doesn't really have turn 2 yet. Oh, well, now he has one.
Nerdy Nag is actually a very good card against Rogue.
Yeah.
It's kind of good in Rogue in the same, or in Shaman in the same way it's good in Zoo, right? If they clear the board, you get the 4/4, so you automatically kind of get something going on the new board you're trying to develop. And I don't think you would ever consider making a totem over playing the egg. So
exactly, and there's so many ways to activate it, right?
Right.
Two activators already in the hand. We have Rapid Weapon on the egg, or even Flame Tongue Totem on the egg.
I'm so excited to see the Thassakar Totemic being played. Hopefully next turn.
It's bet time. It's bet time. Real quick, I'm saying Manatite Totem off Thassakar Totemic.
I'll take a Totem Golem.
I will say Stone Claw.
Okay.
Okay.
So I think you and I are actually tied over the course of the Hearthstone World Championship.
That's true.
One apiece.
But what Pimping Ho is thinking is, of course, if he gets that Flame Tongue Totem, 1 out of 8, he wants to play this Thassakar Totemic on the left side. Oh.
Yeah, we're all wrong.
That's not what you want.
We all lose.
Yeah.
I mean, it's one more damage. I agree. It's not necessarily what you want, but... Mm-hmm. Actually, it might even just be the worst one you could have gotten.
Not really good. It's the only totem that dies to the hero power. And Osaka here is just going to go ahead and play
class.
The Vial Teacher, play the Preparation, and the Eviscerate to spawn 2-1-1s. That's such a big swing turn. Exactly what rogues are looking for in turn 4.
Yeah, an amazing tempo play. And you know about Thassakar Totemic, I think still, even though you get a 1-1, it's not absolutely bad because you get 4 free in power for Kunana.
This is one of those things where he overkilled the Thassakar Totemic by 2 damage,
right.
But that's okay. He managed to generate another 1-1 student from the Violent Teacher, or Violent Teacher.
Oh man!
I swear she looks very friendly. Violent Teacher, and more importantly, he's taken tempo away from the Shaman, and Shaman tends to have a really hard time getting tempo back.
Well. That's one of the answers, one of the few answers that Pimping Ho actually has. This Rock Rider and Flame Tongue combination. It's gonna deal exactly 5 damage, spawn a 4/4, which is right now a 6/4, and also gets the Zombie Child to fill out his curve.
Yeah, Pimping Ho is fighting back. One of the tempo taking cards is Lightning Storm,
yeah.
And he is playing one Elytra.
That's right.
Yeah, it's kind of hard not to bring Lightning Storm. It's a removal card that, ever since minions have become stickier, it's become a little bit less valuable because you're essentially paying 5 mana for 2 or 3 damage, you never know which. So it's one of those cards where you feel like you have to run it because it's your best form of board clear. Obviously, Elemental Destruction destroys both sides of the board, but it's not one of those cards you're ever really happy to see or use until it rolls all like 3s or you have spell damage, and then you're like, all right, Lightning Storm, you're okay, but.
Yeah, I mean, it's not bad. Even against Rogue is actually a very, very good card.
Speaking about Lightning Storm.
Exactly, because.
Nobody was talking about you, Lightning Storm, I swear. I said nothing but nice things.
Yeah.
Anyways.
Let's see if he gets a spell power totem and guarantees the kill. No. So he could go for the roll here because after a Lightning Storm this turn, he doesn't need to play the Lightning Storm next turn, which means that Dr. Boom could come out in turn 7. So he does go ahead and uses this. See if he gets a lucky roll on the Shredder here.
He really wants to kill the Shredder.
Oh.
He misses that. Alright, this minion might be very important. If he...
Yeah, but... Oh, okay. That's pretty fair.
Okay, so it wasn't bad for Pimping Ho. Obviously, the best outcome was just killing the Shredder there and killing the 1-1 with the 2-3 as well.
Yeah,
just keeping it that would
have been huge.
And not having the 4-3 damage. But that was something that he was able to do. So now he has the tempo advantage here, and he has the mana totem for next turn to draw some cards.
Oh yeah, Pimping Ho is sitting in a very good spot here. We see Osaka's only play right now. Well, I mean, not only play, but Farseer seems to be the most logical choice, right? It doesn't even get the Battlecry effect.
Right.
And, you know, sapping a minion here doesn't feel that good.
Farseer weapon up.
He's gonna go ahead and do that anyways.
Yeah, he just really wants to take board. He tried this earlier with the play with the Violet Teacher and the prep to just try to get that board, basically kick the Shaman off of it. And he's gonna just go ahead and do it again. And oh wow, mana, the overload is really hurting Pimping Ho here.
With the sap, he's forcing Pimping Ho to either play that Nerubian or something else, and he knows he has the weapon buff that he will be able to use next turn to actually kill whatever minion is being played.
That's true.
So just keep the tempo and be the one. Like, he needs to have the tempo till turn 7 so that he can play sprint in a situation where he is the one leading.
Yeah, we see here the Totem Golem is not a super obvious play. Yes, you can use it and then hero power, but then you can't Dr. Boom next turn.
Exactly.
So
you only have 6 mana.
I was going to say, you may just Nerubian here and float a Mana Crystal.
Yeah, Nerubian is pretty good. It's a little bit better than Spire Tank.
Right.
So why not?
Yeah, it's decent, but this is exactly what Sosgaga wanted.
Yeah, he needs to find something a little bit more flexible off the top. And Backstab, obviously not really any good. He could have cleared the Nerubian anyway with the hero power.
What's cool about Backstab is that it does make your oil combo so that the Farseer could gain some attack.
Wow.
And then you can actually go face for a little bit of more pressure. It's not too much, because Pepe Ho is at 30 health, unscathed right now until this point.
Yeah, that was pretty good for Skaka being in that box up there.
Oh, wow.
Normally you just play Dr. Boom, but how much damage is there? Not enough yet.
I think you still just play Dr. Boom.
Yeah, here. You definitely play Dr. Boom here. It's so much board.
Think about your options.
I don't think you think too much about this one.
You think a little bit, and you realize it is turn 7.
And it's green.
Dr. Boom costs 7 mana, so you just go ahead.
Not even that. If the Feral Spirits were like 3/2s instead of 2/3s, then one of them doesn't trade out with your Earthen Ring Forest here, so you're probably going to have to trade 2. You're getting back in that position where you're overloading yourself. Obviously, with this, you're kind of just hoping the Boom Bots end up taking care of the 6/3.
Right. And
the problem with Feral Spirits was also like the weapon was actually buffed, so Blade Flurry clears the board.
Right. All right, let's see what Oskaka chooses to do here. He could use the backstab and kill off the Dr. Boom, but that does mean that he loses his Earthen Ring Forest here. And rows are really, really important. They only play X amount of minions. So, that's why Warriors is such a bad matchup, because Warriors just clear all their minions. And Bloodlust, not really too necessary now.
No. Bloodlust, not going to do a lot here, but it's one of the inclusions I really like in Pimping Ho's deck. Mm-hmm. Kind of looking at the meta and kind of what he thought would be most useful in
have that Feral Spirit for next turn.
Yeah, it's just one of those things, again, where overloading yourself to walk into a Blade Flurry feels like too many bad things at once. It doesn't really feel like a winning gamble. So I agree with you, Nimshai. I like him just not doing that. And yeah, he's a little bit rewarded here.
Seven damage on the Boombots. That's quite a bit.
It might matter. And then there's second Hex, so a lot of spells.
Yeah, I mean, 8 mana Hex doesn't look like it's too bad right now. You know your opponent only runs one copy of Lotheb. So, just pass your turn. And, Ping Ping Ho might even go the strategy of clearing every single rogue minion, because without minions, they actually don't have any more burst damage. Oil needs that target to, get the maximum potential.
I really like the Hex here, too. I don't think you're giving up too much. And again, this actually kind of goes to my general complaint with Feral Spirits in a Shaman deck anyway, is I don't think these days they're necessarily as impactful as they used to be. So we see Feral Spirit, he keeps passing on it because it's not in a situation where it actually affects the board much.
Yeah, but this means also Oskaka can actually sprint here if he wants to. He can develop board with Azure Trick. He still has the one having tempo, and that's exactly what he wants as a rogue deck. And for Pimping Ho, the board is clear.
Yep.
It's a really bad spot overall.
Yeah, this is not going to help his condition or win condition of Bloodlusting. So he needs to find a way to get back on this board. He's already used a Lightning Storm, and the Rogue, oddly enough, the Oil Rogue, is the one dominating the board with minions. So.
Yeah.
Well, one of them is a Frog.
Oh, I mean, that's still a minion. Let's not be rude to the Frog.
It's a beast.
If Oskaka somehow top decks Kill Command as a Rogue, that's going to be very relevant. Houndmaster could also come down.
Or there are no spell slingers. So for Pimpico, this is a really bad spot. Haunted Creeper is not helping him a lot. Feral Spirit is a must play. You are obviously afraid of something, even something like Fan of Knives with double spell damage can clear those Feral Spirit.
Double spell damage does look really, really threatful. And Pimpico might even have to Hex an Azuric, and that does not what you want. Azuric already drew a card for Oskaka.
Well, I'm pretty sure he realizes the only other target that he would have ever looked to Hex was probably just going to be Edwin Van Cleave.
That's true.
But if a big Edwin Van Cleave comes down past this point, it might just be too much anyway.
That's true.
Are we going to see a Battle Frog?
Yeah, we might see a very, very angry frog.
With the oil?
I believe the term is Battle Toads. We're going to see Battle Toads.
Battle Toad.
Yeah, okay. Battle Toad soon. So Osaka has another sprint in hand too, so he can just keep digging for more resources and more ways to possibly end it. And you know, Shaman is on that Shaman curse right now, where he's not drawing cards. He's just kind of forced to use what he has, and he's really just kind of walking minions into the buzzsaw he imagines there of like, not even an imagined buzzsaw now, it's a real one. the blade flurry.
All right, well, let's go and fish for more efficient answers. Perhaps draw a preparation?
Nope.
Well, at this point, he can do anything he wants. He just needs to stay behind the Bloodlust range, and he has double taunt. Like,
yeah, I was gonna say, he has his frogs just holding the line, and I mean, Pippin, it kind of doesn't even matter, because Pippin Ho doesn't really have the board to try to go for the Bloodlust. So, I mean, the frogs are there, they're doing the right thing, they're trying to keep him safe, but they have a very lax job as far as trying to protect him, because there's not
so
too much going on.
Options.
Is it like spoiling a bit a new class in the Heroes of Warcraft? Maybe like Valyria is trying to become the witch doctor, you know, throwing frogs?
Safely say that's not a thing.
Okay.
Don't worry about
confirmed.
It.
Confirmed.
Yeah. Confirmed, Valyria is a rogue, not a witch doctor. That's the confirmation.
The frogs are confusing, though.
No, actually, because it came from Hex. Very straightforward.
Oh, man. All right. You got me there.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
What about spiders?
Yeah, I don't know how Shaman gets spiders. That's more kind of a Diablo thing, as far as I know it. But we see here, Osaka just has so many answers in hand. And Pippin Ho is not really even going to necessarily be putting down enough minions, generally speaking, to really require all those answers. So Osaka can really take his time here and figure out how he wants to win this game.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, Pippin Ho right now needs to figure out what to do. He's in a very good position. He is with his Shaman that he loves, but if he loses this game, he is eliminated and Osaka goes through to the semifinal. Osaka, though, I was talking to him a bit before, and he said he's super confident.
I
pointed out that the matchup actually favors Pippin Ho because the Freeze Mage is a weak link, but Osaka said, it doesn't matter. I'm confident I'm gonna win.
Yeah, I was looking to see if, I guess, how his nerves would hold up.
Right.
Because even, you know, obviously he said that in the interview, and Vitality Tone is not ill, but, you know, he said before that, you know, he's one of those players who comes to live events and it can be really a little bit jarring for him, and he focuses more on the crowd, he focuses more on his opponent in front of him as opposed to, you know, making really good plays. And, yeah, we haven't seen that affect him at all. As you said earlier, you know, he is really playing just very, very tight Hearthstone right now.
Yeah.
He's not making any misplays that I've seen. I don't know about you guys, but...
Yeah.
No, he's playing really well.
Yeah.
And I'm just looking at double Fan of Knives with that spell damage.
Oh, man. And a Valid Teacher to make some more, you know, 1-1s.
Yeah. It's tough.
It's tough having all the answers.
Well, it's tough for Pippin Ho. I mean, it's
yeah.
like the dream
really
situation
is.
For Osaka. Yeah, Osaka is like, yeah, I brought Rogue specifically for this, you know,
so
for these matchups.
If you're a fan of Osaka, and if you're a fan of Knives,
uh-huh.
you should be really happy now.
Oh.
Yeah. I'm a big fan of Knives. Thanks to a card.
I'm a fan of Knives, too.
I'm a fan of Violet Teacher and a double fan of Knives here. That is the play
exactly.
I want to make.
Maybe you just go with the Think Masters.
Pay attention, class.
This is just way too efficient.
Yeah.
Dealing 2 damage across the board 2 times.
Clearing
it's
everything off the board and then just... Kind of slowly,
well.
Gingerly skipping to the finish line. Yeah.
Oh,
man. And a preparation as well. Might as well, so you play the Earthen Ring Farseer. Osaka's looking in a very dominating position.
Pippin Ho is going to need to draw, I think, Deathwing off the top or
Elemental Destruction. But no. That's
another reactive card.
Oh, man.
Well, this time elements didn't really work, so he needs to counter damage. Can he do anything? Feral Spirit can block at least 6 points of damage here.
Yeah, he's gonna try his hard to, you know, weather the storm, but the storm might be too much as Osaka has deadly poison, oil, and a flurry, and an eviscerate to top it off.
Look at the difference in number of cards that have been drawn. Like, obviously, we don't necessarily right here have access to the exact numbers, but you can just tell. Look how many more cards are in Pippin Ho's deck.
Way too much. Yep, Osaka realizes that he's got lethal no matter what happens.
And this means Osaka is gonna win game number 4 and win the whole match versus Pippin Ho 3-1. On the back of the flurry, minions attack. Osaka is your victor.
GG's and congratulations to Osaka. He's gonna meet Tice in the semifinals.
Yeah, the battle for Europe will soon begin, but Pippin Ho came to this, obviously the Hearthstone World Championship, played extremely well, took out Purple, the America's Championship, obviously at opening week, and made a real reputation for himself, and I think has a kind of developed his personality that people are gonna wanna follow. We saw a little bit of him in Legendary Series Season 1, I believe it was, with the Machine Gun Mage deck, as he was calling it. So
yeah.
He's really developing a He's developing a real reputation for himself.
Yeah, that was really impressive, but it looks like Rachel is ready and waiting with the winner of the match.
That's right, guys. I'm down here with Ostkaka, and you talked a little bit about your nerves in your media piece. I wanted to know, did your nerves affect you at all during this match?
Actually, yes. I was getting a little bit more comfortable, but then now you see BlizzCon here. There's a ton of people. It's really loud, and so it's, you know, I got a little bit nervous, yeah.
Well, your instincts did not fail you. You made it all the way through. You're going to be playing in the quarterfinals. But I wanted to know, was there any point where you feel like you did slip up?
I'm not entirely sure. I know that I wasn't playing optimally all the time, but I can't like pinpoint anything specific. I felt like I played pretty well overall.
Well, you're going into the quarterfinals, and your opponent is going to be Tice. I want to know, do you have any particular thoughts on facing him?
I think I should be slightly favored, just lineup-wise, but Tice is probably the best player besides me in the top eight, so it's definitely scary.
Besides you, you're feeling confident, aren't you?
Yeah.
Well, I love to see that confidence on your face. And once again, congratulations, Ostkaka. And to all of you just joining us, you've come at a perfect time. Up next will be our Elky versus Daniel Negreanu exhibition match, followed by a very special edition of Challenge Stone Live from BlizzCon. Don't go anywhere. We've got our match highlights brought to you by Windows 10 DVR Replay. We'll be right back.
The 2015 World Championship.